Okay, hi everyone once again. Thank you so much for joining. I think we'll just start as the rest of guys join us as we progress. So in today's session, we will definitely cover Reef Framework, UiPath Reef Framework. So Reef Framework is the acceptable, you can call it the code standard when you're developing your boards and your solutions. And it is acceptable globally, and it's one of the approved frameworks from UiPath. So today we will be taken through by one of our team members, and the agenda for today is just to get a sense of what is UiPath Reef Framework, how does it work, what are the different stages in Reef Framework. You notice that there's a bit around opening an application. We call it initialization stage. There's a bit around killing historical process errors or systems that were there, so you'll be able to dive deeper. We'll also take you through in terms of how do you get transactions, assuming you're pulling your data from an Excel or from a different queue, how do you get those particular transactions, and how do you upload them to your orchestrator? And after that, we'll now proceed and do the actual processing. So here is just taking that particular transaction and executing it. So executing it, I'm assuming you're pushing that data to a system or you are updating a status somewhere. So we'll be able to take you through that process as well. Then lastly is how do you end your automation? So here we're looking at how do you close gracefully all the different systems that you've been working on. How do you close them successfully? And if you need to send an updated status report at the tail end of it, how do you do that? It will be purely a hands-on demo. So you will have majority of the session will be using UiPath Studio. I believe at this point you have already downloaded and interacted with the same. So it will be purely a hands-on demo. Same case, if you have questions and answers, you can leave them on chat, or better yet, you can ask at the tail end, but I would prefer you leave on chat so that you're able to respond as we proceed. So let me introduce the team for the today. So Zakaria will be the one taking us through this particular session, session 6. And myself, Christina is absent today, but we have presence from Vibor. So probably Vibor, if you can just say a quick hi. I know Rohit is also in the background, but Vibor, if you can, you can just say hi to the Kenyan and African team as well. Okay, I will definitely bring him up as we proceed, but we'll have Vibor, we have Rohit as well on the call. So with no further ado, let me just welcome Zakaria. So Zakaria is one of our senior developer in Jubilee Insurance, and he'll be down taking us through. Zakaria, welcome.
So thank you, Jonathan, for this opportunity and greetings to the team. Thank you for joining today's session on introduction to the Reef Framework. It will generally be like a deep dive on Reef Framework. So first, we begin by understanding the basic meaning of a framework. So a framework, in this case, in computer programming, we say it's an abstraction in which software providing generic functionality can be selectively changed by additional user-written code, thus providing application-specific software. This is like customizing code and making it to have that functionality that you need. So we can gain deeper understanding by first understanding the general meaning of a framework in it being just a template that helps you to design. In this case, in the computer world, and for this case, it is that template which will help us design automation processes. So now, Reef Framework is a UiPath Studio template. It's built using state machines, yeah? And it is the starting point for all RPA projects. Most importantly, you find that projects that do require scalable processing or enterprise automation are developed using UiPath Reef Framework. So it is created to fit all the best practices regarding this is logging, effective logging, exception handling, and also application initialization. It is also built to be able to handle or tackle any business scenario. So on the screen, I've shared a screenshot of the UiPath reframework architecture. So you might note that there are a bit of states. So this is a state machine. We named it, it is named general business process. And you can see we have the start there, and then we have the states. In total, you have the post states being the initialization state, the get transaction data state, the process transaction state, and also the end process state. So it's just a template that is built using state machines. I've talked about the handling and the logging mechanisms and all the states that pertain the reframework. So you'll find that it has a lot of benefits. Some of them being it allows us to think of processing data in a transaction way, in a transactional way. Each data is processed per transaction. It is also built to fit or to work with the orchestrator directly. I will talk about the config file where we do the updates on the about the queue folder, the queue to be used, where to upload those queue items, and so on and so forth. It is also globally known by developers. It is reusable, scalable. There's high error handling mechanisms that have been implemented. There's also high volume resistance, high error resistance, and so on. So many benefits that are you can find on UiPath reframework. So directly, we'll go to dealing or just a brief introduction of these states before we dive deeper into them, each one of them. So we talked about the init stage. So these are the stages of reframework. There are four actual stages of reframework. So we've talked about the init. So init being the first state. And in this state, it is mainly used to initialize the required applications. Probably you want to log in into an application. That's just initialization. This is why you do that. Then we also have the init state being responsible for initializing settings by reading and storing configuration data. The configuration, the data that will be stored, we'll see the file later on called the config file in a dictionary. And also it allows the process or the robot to kill unnecessary applications and just prepare for the process to start running efficiently. We also have the get transaction. It's this is the state where data is retrieved. So it is used to get transaction from the queue. So you have created a queue on the orchestrator, you need to retrieve data. This is the state where you retrieve that data, the get transaction state. We also, on the same state, we can retrieve data from data tables, from folders, from databases, and many other sources, including APIs. So when we talk about the process transaction stage, which is the that stage in this case, we'll talk about processing of these transactions that have been retrieved. It's like a journey. So the transaction have been gotten from the get transaction stage. Now we want to process these transactions. This is a state where we now process these transactions individually, one by one. And if there's no record process, the robot automatically moves to the last state, which is the end transaction state. So when we talk about the end transaction state, this is the final state of the reframework, and it ends the robot successfully and closes all the applications in this case. After the bot has finished processing all the data and there is no data in the queue or in the data table, it will log out of all applications. We'll see an activity or a workflow that is called close all applications, where all applications are closed at this state, irrespective of if it is a failed or a successful transaction. So we move to the next. Now this will be a deep dive, so I'll just go ahead and share my UiPath Studio. I hope you can see. And this is what you're talking about. I'm on Studio right now. I hope it's clear. And I want us to just go deeper into the reframework architecture, be able to understand what it contains, how it works, and so on and so forth. So I'm just going to navigate to the main, and you can see as the screenshot I had displayed before, you can see we have the four states here, the initialization, the get transaction data, the process transaction, and the end transaction, end process state. So directly I'll start moving into the initialization stage. So generally the initialization stage, okay, so first of all, let me just close it so that I can show you guys how we get to this state, how do we get to this page, the main page, how we start creating a Reef Framework template. So I'm just going to go to home, and then on the home page, you will see there is a new from template, and then under it, the first one, there is a Robotic Enterprise Framework. Which has a description there where it says you can create a transactional business process that follows best practice for large scale deployments in this case. So I'm just going to click on it. So you get this pop-up where you now name the process that you want to build. So I'll just name it as Africa Series 2 Demo. One, something of the sort, and then add a description. So yes, so this is how you create it. You can also select the compatibility and the language that you want to use in this case. So I'm just going to go directly to create. And just like that, we have created our template. When you click open main workflow, this is where now you find your template. So this is the template that I was talking about, the template that we use. So directly now, let's go into the initialization. You can see there's a description here that the initialization state is responsible for reading the configuration file, initialize applications that will be used all throughout the process. So just getting into the initialization. So initialization essentially is the entry point of any process built in this framework or Reef Framework in this case. It's a state where the process reads the settings and initializes applications to ensure prerequisite or everything that pertains to the initialization of all the settings has been done before the process can even begin. So when you look into what I'm displaying right here, I've expanded the initialization state, and you can see that the first description there is it's just the same as just saying initializing of applications used in the process. So the first step is you'll note that Reef Framework offers us a kind of error handling mechanisms. That's why you'll see a lot of try catch. So try catch is just try to do something. If it doesn't, then handle it in a specific way. So in this initialization state, you can see we have the entry where we have the try, and then you can see there's an assign activity that is there. And it's saying system exception, assign it to nothing. And if this is a fast run, read ROCCO configuration file, and then proceed. So you see, if there is a fast run in this case, we always check on the config. So if the config is nothing, then proceed to initializing the settings. So within the initializing settings, you'll find that there is where we now read the config file. Just quickly show, take us through the config file and what it is and how we use it in Reef Framework. So, okay, so it has opened. So I had opened another one. So we are going to use this config file. So the config file in this case, you can see it is, it allows us to kind of separate our project settings from our main workflows. So one of the characteristics of the config file is that it has three sheets, yeah? So the config file generally allows us to easily maintain our project and also to allow us to quickly change configuration values. For example, I've changed my queue name. Instead of going back to my code, I just want to come here on the config and just change that code. Yeah, it is a good practice to keep project settings separated mainly from workflow themselves. This is to allow easier manipulation, also to allow us to kind of just change the values flexibly instead of hard coding them. So again, as I had said, it contains three sheets. The first sheet is the settings sheet. There's also the constants sheet, and also there is the assets sheet. So we're just going to deep dive into these three sheets, seeing what they contained and what can be changed. So the first one is the settings sheet. So within the settings sheet, as I am displaying as of the moment, you store any configuration that is related to the business process, any specific configuration related to the business process. So you find that we have, for example, in this case, we have an orchestrator queue name. I've written it as the value, I've given it a value of attendance details queue. And there's also a description. So we have the name and the value. So when we proceed, this is where we also add, for example, URLs. You want to log in into an application, you add the URL in the thought of that this URL might change or something. So we also have things like file paths. These are specific to the business process. Things like credentials that you can use to log into applications and any other specific piece of information that is related to the business process. So that's the settings sheet. And now let's proceed to the constants sheet. So the constants sheet just stores anything, let's say technical settings that are useful for the developers and in specific the process itself. So you find that among others, it contains information such as the number of retries. You can see a max retry number. The number of consecutive system exceptions that are allowed in that process. Things like default paths, they are also there. Things like static log message paths, you can also include them there. So hard coding values, as I had said, is not always the right approach. Using the config object enables us to do easy global adjustments. If you want to adjust a value globally, the config is the right way to go. It allows us to smoothly switch environments. I believe this is so. When you want to switch probably from development to a test or from development to test and then maybe later on to production, the config file allows that flexibility. It is also when we talk about the max retry number, it is UiPath strongly recommend us not to set a different number within the config file for projects which use queue items as input data. In these situations, you find when you're using queues, there is a setting within the orchestrator that you set the max retry number. And this setting on the orchestrator overrides the one that has been set on the config file. So let's go for the other ones, maybe the ones that you want to use things like data tables. For that one, you can just hard code it on the config file. Lastly, we check on the assets. So the assets sheet defines assets stored within the orchestrator. So you have defined assets in the orchestrator and they are being used within the current automation process. So this is where you define them. So as we have seen, like in the previous sheets, we use the first column name for the key in our config dictionary. We use the second column, in this case, the asset, to retrieve the asset with that name from the orchestrator and store its value in the config dictionary. So in the third column, we have the orchestrator asset folder. So which you want to specify which folder this asset is stored. And point to note, if you leave it empty, the bot will use the default folder. So that's just basically it about the config file. We'll be using it as we go. So That's just basically it about the initialization, where we read the config file, initialize all applications. So let me just dive next into the get transaction data state. So this state retrieves one by one transaction items containing the data to be processed. So remember, we have initialized the applications. A queue is ready with queue items, and we need to process them. We have done the initialization of all applications, opened the required applications. Now it's a time to kind of process these transactions individually, one by one. So within the get transaction data, there are possible actions that take place depending on the state of the process. The very first thing, as you can see, we have a function there. We have an activity called check stop signal. So it's the very first to check if a stop request was sent from the orchestrator. This probably is when you are running a process and you need to stop it. So the very first thing the bot or the robot checks in this state is to check if anyone has tried to send a stop request. If it was sent from the orchestrator, it will proceed to end all the processes gracefully. Then there's also another thing that is if a new transaction comes next. So if there's a new transaction which comes next, it proceeds to process the transaction in the next state. There's also another option of when all the transactions have been operated on. And this leads also to end the process. So the get transaction item activity sometimes may fail. Let me just show you. So sometimes it may fail. And for example, when, for example, there is no internet, or for example, the service is unavailable. So to handle such exceptions, the get transaction item activity is pressed inside a retry scope or a try catch, and a try catch, sorry, activity. So this allows us to handle any exception that might arise in this case. As you can see, there's a try catch to try get transaction data, just to be able to handle those kind of exceptions that arise. So that's it about the get transaction data. Let's proceed to the next state, which is the process state. So as you can see, the process state processes a single transaction. The result of the processing can be either a success, a business exception, or a system exception. So let's dive deep into it. So when we talk about process transaction, we have said we process the transactional view of ReFramework. We view each data item as a single transaction where we process it. So as you also might expect, the process transaction state starts with the try-catch activity. Again, the error handling mechanism being seen here about the ReFramework. So inside the try block, we invoke the process workflow file. So you see that here we have invoked the process, this workflow, which is called the process workflow. So within it, this is where the activities which will do the activities, or maybe the workflows, you have generated workflows which will process the actual data are placed. You invoke them within the process workflow. I'm just going to open it. So when you open it, you see that there is invoke major steps of business processes. So in this case, if you have built a workflow or you want to add activities to process this data, this is why you place them. So that's just the process transaction state. So again, as I had mentioned, the state has three possible outcomes in this case. So there is one which is success, there is number two, which is the business rule exception, and also there is the third one, which is the system exception. So when we have a success outcome, we will, I'm just going to show you at the end here. So these are the outcomes that we expect from this state. So it's either a system exception where the destination will be the initialization state. If it's a business exception, it goes to the get transaction state. And if it's a success, it goes to the get transaction data state. So when you talk about the success transition, this means a transaction was successful. No exceptions have occurred in this case. So it's triggered when no exception has been encountered and during the processing in this particular state. And the automation attempts to get the next transaction item now will proceed the next. So when we talk about the next one, which is the business exception, so this is triggered when, for example, a predefined business rule is broken. For example, some data does not meet some item in the data does not meet a specific requirement or threshold. Then the developer can explicitly implement the logic to throw the exception by using the throw activity in this case. So the business exception, you must know that this is explicitly must be explicitly be implemented within the logic. It just doesn't come. So you have to use the throw activity in this case to be able to throw that business exception. So when we talk about the system exception, it's triggered mainly when a system exception is encountered during processing. For example, you are logging in and then the robot was expecting something, then it did not come, then that's a system exception. So the automation in this case sets the correct status for the item and launches the actual retry mechanisms. I had talked about this. So when the retry mechanism is set, we will see. Let me just go there. So we have three outcomes from the process state. So we have talked about, so right now we're talking about the system exception. So you'll see the arrow directs it to the initialization state. So in this case, the applications or the bot proceeds to set or initialize the applications again and proceeds now to get another transaction and or retry the transaction that in this case had failed. So that's it about the process transaction state. We proceed to the end process state. So the end process state is just to close all the applications. So once all transactions have been successfully completed, the robot enters the end state, which is the phase where it closes all the applications. I'm just going to go into it. So it then again, we see the try being used here just to handle any exceptions, any errors that might arise. So you see that it tries to close all the applications. This is just terminating the applications that were being used and ending the process. So basically that's it about the four states of free framework, the config file, very important. And now I believe we can proceed to actually now understanding how exactly we can use reframework, for example, to automate a process. So the key or the critical part of reframework is to understand that it works with a dispatcher and a performer, or in other words, it's called the producer and consumer, the model, the producer and consumer model. So you see there's something called dispatcher. In this case, it's also called the producer. So this is a process that mainly pushes transaction items to an orchestrator queue. So I'm just going to open up real quick the demo here, just to be able to take you through. Okay, so when I talk about a dispatcher, I mean a process that allows the update of a queue. In this case, I'm going to use a queue, an orchestrator queue. So just opening, I'd made something here. Yeah, so it extracts data from one or maybe multiple sometimes sources and kind of uses that data to create queue items for robots to process. So it's just basically an update to a performer. So we've talked about producer and consumer, dispatcher and performer. So let's see what a performer is. A performer is a separate process or is a process that is developed to pull now the transaction items from the orchestrator queue that has been updated by the dispatcher and processes them as needed or as per the requirements. So queue items, again, I reiterate, they are processed one at a time individually. So the performer is basically the process that kind of processes these transactions. It uses a lot of error handling and retry mechanisms, as we have seen, and we are going to see this in the actual demo. So for example, let me take you through the dispatcher that I've built here. So these are this workflow. For example, I've just added the comments that it reads Excel containing, for example, the attendant details and proceeds to add them to a queue for processing. So this dispatcher is it reads from an Excel, then it proceeds to update this information to a queue where we now pull them using the performer for processing. So I'm just going to give you a background of the use case I'm trying to use here. So I've developed this bot as a demo for today. So the simple use case today will be we want, or rather, I want to build a bot that can send appreciation emails to attendants of this session, the UiPath Africa Series 2 session. So with us, I'm just going to share the data that I have. So I'm assuming that I have received this data, for example, from my lead. Let me just go there, just a second, and show the kind of data I'm trying to use for this demo. So this is the Excel. So yes, so you've noted that I have a list of attendance of this event. I also have the number of Africa Series 2 sessions that they have attended, and also have the email addresses in this spreadsheet that is named Sheet 1. So we need to develop a bot that or an email needs to be sent in this use case to each of them with a personalized message putting forward an appreciation and awarding them a certificate of attendance as a token of this of attending as a token of appreciation for attending the sessions. So in this case, we will use the dispatcher and the performer model just to be able to illustrate very well how this works. So which is a critical aspect again in the reframework process. So in the reframework automation. So this is how we are going to do it. The dispatcher will read rows from this Excel and from the input spreadsheet and then add the data to the queue. And then each queue item will have both the name, the number of sessions attended, and the email from one spreadsheet row. So each, like for example, we have Zakaria Machara, the email and the number of events. I just show you within the queue. Then the performer will be able to retrieve this information, an item, each item from the same queue, and do the necessary actions using this data. Like for example, replacing values. What I've done is that I've created a template certificate in this case that will be used by the bot just to be able to replace the values that needs to be replaced and then send the email. So I'm just going to take you through the dispatcher. So the dispatcher in this case, we have said it is adding these items to the queue, the items that are within the Excel. So you see, I've started just with the log, then I've read that Excel, and then bulk add queue items. So this is an activity that is going to allow me to add the queue items from Excel, from the data table DT attendance to the queue. So, and then it's just as simple as that, and then it will log when it's done. So I'm just going to show you the queue that I've created. So you see, here is the queue that I've created. So the queue is called attendance details queue. So we can view the transaction. So I have filtered by new, so there are no new no new transaction. So I'm just going to run the dispatcher and just show you how it will work. So this is just to update the queue. So allow me to just run in debug mode so that we can see. So you can see starting dispatch, dispatch is done. So for this case, I've chosen to use only two for the purpose of the demonstration. So I'm just going to show you the two transactions, just refresh this, and we have two transactions. So as I had said, if you view the details of each transaction, we have the name, we have the email, and we have the number of events attended. So we go ahead and then we check the other one. It also has the same kind of structure, the name, the email under specific data, and then the number of events attended. So that's just basically the dispatcher. So that's just it. So we are just going to go directly to the performer. So here is the performer. Yeah. So what I've done is, let me just go to, back to the main and show you. As I had said, we process transactions within the process transaction state. So we have invoked the framework has already has invoked the process workflow. So if you go to open the process workflow here in this case, so you'll see that the framework already has the log started process. So and then I have placed my performer here. I've invoked it as a workflow. It's called generating certificates. So if you go to generating certificates workflow, so you see it gets the details and just generates the certificates and shares them to the attendant through the email. So if you look at it, we have the email subject, and then we have just defined it as a string, just simply for the purpose of the demonstration. We have the email template. This is a path to the email template. Then there is a certification template. This is the path to it. And then we have the generated. This is what will finally be generated. How is it named? I've chosen to concatenate a path and the attendant name just to uniquely identify the certificate by the name of the attendant. So you also have the series link, which will be used in the body of the email. So just quickly go through the email template. So the email template is here. So I created this just as a template. So it reads, it's just a simple text file, the attendee, thank you for joining us, and so on and so on. And then there is attached is your certificate of attendance as a token of appreciation. Kindly also see the attached link where now you can access those resources, those previous sessions, and so on and so forth. Then there's also just the salutation, warm regards, you're part of a series two team. So that's just basically the template. So if you look at the certificate of attendance template, so this is just something I created to allow us just for the purpose of this demo. So you see there is UiPath community certificate of attendance. This certifies that. So the body is supposed to just kind of pick this template, do the processing, replace the attendant name with the correct name, and then just send it through an email. So that's the two templates that I'm going to use. So just proceeding. So in this case, I'm just copying the file. There's this activity copy file to copy the file just to make sure I have a new version each time for each transaction. So it's copying the template to a new folder. And then I'm logging that we are starting now the generation of a certificate for specific. In this case, we have used the variable in attendant name. It's an argument. I just take you through that. And then I've used Word application scope to just replace the text within the document with the attendant name. So I've also used the save document as PDF activity just to be able to save the document as PDF. Next, I've read the text file, which contains the email that I had shown you. And then the output is to a variable, a text variable called email to send. So within the email to send, I have just done some manipulation where I've said the email to send replace the attendee with the actual name of the specific attendee that we're using, and also replace the link with the series link. So that's just manipulating the email so that it fits or it is customized as per needs. I'm just going to comment this out. Then I have the use Gmail. So in this case, I'm using Gmail. This is my personal email. And then I'm going to send the email to the specific client. Remember, we have the email within the a transaction item. So with a field called email in this case. So in this case, I'll be pulling the email of the attendee and sending it to him or her. And then I'll also have some attachments as generated by the Word application scope. This is named generation cert PDF. So this is just a path to that PDF. I also have an email subject, which I had defined. And then we send it now to the client. So I'm just going to quickly delete these comments. I think they're a bit unnecessary. Okay, so we have that. And then, so just quickly to show you how I have pulled the transactions, the transaction. So, okay, so just go to process transaction, and then here we have it. So in this case, I have created these three as in arguments within the generating certificates workflow. So I have the in attendant name as an argument. So to it, I have passed in transaction item dot specific content. Again, this is how we retrieve the information or what is held within the queue. So it's the in transaction item dot specific content that is within the name, and then you convert it to string so that it can match with the argument that you created. Then we have the email and also the number of events that the particular attendee has attended. So this is how we pull the transactions from the queue. So again, so just to mention again, remember in our config file, we have done our configurations, just basic configurations within the setting. So you'll see that the orchestrator queue name in this case is the attendance details queue. So this matches the queue that you have created. You can see it's attendance details queue. And then we also have the orchestrator queue folder. So the orchestrator queue folder in this case is ref demo / Africa series 2 demo. And then this is what I've put within the settings sheet. And then you also have the log business process name. This is just how the robot should refer to the process while running. So you can see it allows grouping of log data for two or more sub-processes under the same business process. So this is just it for our demo. So I'm just going to go directly to the demo. So for this case, I'm running two transactions. So the expectation is my robot will now retrieve the transactions from the queue. First of all, it's just initialization. Yeah. So the initialization stage is where now maybe all the processes or the applications that are being used are prepared. In this case, for example, let me just dive deep into the initialization state so that I can just show you something. And then we have this. We have invoke kill all processes. So for example, I'm going to use Excel. So I've used kill process activity to be able to kill the Excel so that it doesn't interrupt the process flow. I've also used kill Word. If the application Word is open, I'm just going to open. So just open it. So that we can see how it works, the kill process works. Then I'm just going to open Excel. So the bot in this case will first kill all the applications that it's going to use within the process. That is happening within the initialization state. And then and it's going to, if that is successful again, go, it's going to transit as a success and then go to the next state, which is the get transaction, and then the next state, which is process transaction. And then we expect three outcomes, either a success, a business exception, or a system exception. If it's a success, we expect it's going to get the next transaction, process it, and when all the transactions are done, it's going to end the process in the last state, which is the end process state. So I'm just going to quickly run the process. I'm going to just run it. So we're going to see this as it happens. So the process is checking for the validation errors. It's going to compile. Cool. So the first thing, remember, it killed all the applications that it was it is supposed to use. It has taken that, it has updated with the required names. That's the first transaction. And then we should expect, we have two transactions, so we expect it to do two. So currently, I think it's sending the email. It's going to the next transaction, generating the certificate, and sending the email. So we should expect it to find that there are no more transaction data, because remember, we updated two with two transactions. So if it ran well and I refresh this, then exactly there are no transactions. So if you go to all, you'll see that 10 seconds ago and 25 seconds ago, we have some successful transactions. So let me go just to the output, the logs. So you see your process to transactions, and we have also sent them through email. So I'm just going to go quickly and just display if I have received an email. So let me just refresh this. So I was one of the attendees. So this is the template that I was talking about. We can see it has worked. Does it replace the attendee name, also the link. When I click this link, I'll get all the links to the sessions and the presentations. And also attached, also I've received the token of appreciation, a certificate in this case with Jonathan there and also Christina. And yes, perfectly. So we can see the robustness that is within this. So each transaction is being processed each at a time. So as I finish, that's the demo for today. So as I finish, the Reef framework, yeah, of course, as we've seen, it offers robust exception handling mechanisms. This is by use of the retries, the use of initializing applications, the transitions, the use of the try catch in this case. It can automatically recover from failures. For example, if a transaction has failed, you can see it has kind of marked system exceptions, where you now kind of set the number of retries it can do. So this allows it to recover from these failures. It can also it also updates the statuses of transactions. As we have seen from the demo, the status has changed from new to a success. So that allows you to kind of check through the transactions and just do your own investigation. It also aggressively ends execution in case of uncoverable exceptions. So all the information about exceptions is logged within the orchestrator. So it allows us to do our analysis and investigations. So that's it for today. I think we are ready now for the questions, Q&A session.
Thank you, Zach. If anyone has a question, you can just unmute and ask. So maybe just an addition, Zach, if you can just go to the folder path where your XAML or entire project is stored. So if you go to the documentation, I can see it. So if you go to the documentation, you'll be able to get a detailed, just open it. So every time you download the Reef framework template, it gives you a detailed walkthrough. So if you can just scroll through the same, gives you a detailed walkthrough of all those different parameters. So in the event you missed out, let's say, you are into, whereby you are setting your assets and your orchestrator. You can be able to find all that in this particular bit. It also takes you through details step by step. If you just scroll down to till the tail end, it takes you on a detail, gives you more information on what each particular function means. If you had to configure it, what does it mean? How will it affect your process, etc.? So it gives you like a deep dive visibility on the same, on each and every parameter that Zakaria has taken us through. So just to recap what he has done. So one thing first we noticed is that he created a dispatcher. So a dispatcher, like he was able to define it, is it just like prepares your execution. So it takes, so for example, it takes, using the example that he was able to take us through, it opens the Excel, it reads all the different people or the different participants that were present. Then it takes all that particular information and pushes it to orchestrator. So the only reason we are doing that is to avoid having the bot to every time take one transaction, go and process, come back again, take the second transaction, go and process. So we are just taking all that particular information, updating it in the orchestrator. In the event there's an issue from orchestrator perspective, we're able to quickly log, and you're able to, what is able to show us from the queue, you're able to see which ones were successful, which one failed, etc. So that was the first bit. Then the second bit is now the actual dispatcher. So the dispatcher, as what he was able to take us through, it is the one that consumes the framework. So you saw that it was able to kill all initial or historical applications or systems that were there. Then it prepared the application, the int stage as well. It also, assuming in this case it was purely a Word document, or it was purely a Word document, assuming you're using a browser. So in the int, you'll be able to like start that particular process. If you need to log in, you'll be able to log in at that particular stage. If you need to pull your credentials or your assets that you had defined in your config, you're able to do that, to do it at that particular stage. Then once that is completely done, you know, proceed to the get transaction. So get transaction, same case, loops through your queue, get the first transaction, come to your system or your application, then process that particular bit. So it does that until every item in your queue is complete. So at this point, he did mention that there are three stages. There is the success. If the event everything is okay, that's good. We have the business exception. So for example, something from the business, let's say your bot is not supposed to process items above 3,000. There are some specific limits that the business have already preset. So it checks on those ones. If it finds any of those, let's say preset rules, it will update your queue based on that. But this one is specifically as a business rule not met, for example. Same case, we have now the system exception. So you had initially you opened your application, but something happened in between and your application crashed. So what your bot does is that it loads that we had a system exception. So at this point, you can either, it will retry because you're using a reframework, it will definitely retry. But if you have subsequent failures, it will log those, then it will end state. So end state will accommodate both the success as well as a success means that there's no additional data to process, as well as where we have retried the system continuously and it has failed. I think it is, you can set it to a max number of retries. You are able to configure the same. So an end state, like he did mention, here is whereby if you need to send a status report, if you need to close any historical system that you are using, you need to log out. So you're able to define all those parameters at this stage. So at a glance, that's UiPath 3 framework. As he has mentioned, this is the, in any, for enterprise projects that you'll be using, if you're using it in an organization, they'll definitely require that you follow this as the best practice, because it's easy to use, easy to reuse. Error handling is a bit easy as well in this particular framework. So I'm not sure if there's any question up to there. You can place on chat, you can unmute. Yeah, I've seen someone who has chatted directly, who has chatted me directly. Yes. So the question is, will you share the Zamut as well? So definitely yes. So he did mention, I'm not sure if you can still show, there's a way you can create your own XAML, but yes, we'll upload the XAML to a folder and share the rights immediately. So that's something that you will do. The recording for this session as well will be found on the chapter link, the Nairobi chapter. You'll be able to find this as well as it's co-hosted. You'll be able to find that particular link there. So in the next steps, Zachary, if you can just move to what's going to happen. So I believe at this point you have covered the majority of the features in the UAPath. So what you are going to do now is to now do now more practical and hands-on. So we'll dive deeper into web APIs. Okay, so same case, it will be learned by Zakaria. It will be next week. It will be a session that will happen next week. It will be a session that will happen next week, led by Zakaria. So we have attached, should you require additional information, you'll be able to get through our academy. You'll be able to get that through our academy. Same case, if you have any related question, you can be able to reach out to Zakaria or any person now from the team. I believe we have already exchanged
Yes.
So
hello.
David, your hands up.
Yeah. So actually have a bit of a I can say a concern. First of all, is to appreciate the team for preparing such a wonderful informative session and for making sure that we are all in the know-how. So I think just something that catched my eye was the aspect of error handling, which to me is the best practice. My concern was in the part of security. As you are aware, currently the industry practice is privacy by design. So the question that came into my mind was, in terms of security, how are we accommodating security, probably, and mechanisms at which we are ensuring that by default we are protecting the data privacy. So maybe you can mention something on it. I've heard you have talked, Zachary has mentioned something about error handling and the mechanism. Just a brief mention on the same. Thank you.
So thank you, David. I believe in this case, I'm just going to actually show you an example. So just a second. So if I go back to my orchestrator, in this case, so I just a second. So in this case, UiPath has developed a way in which we can ensure that for example, our passwords are well protected. We have the cloud, in this case, the orchestrator cloud that we are using that as of the moment. So if I go back, maybe to just go back and show you. So to the assets. So in this case, for example, you want to store credentials, in this case, just to provide, just to kind of protect them. So for example, I want to store the logins to my Gmail account. So I just have to create an asset. So if you are to create an asset, in this case, you'll choose that you want to, for example, store a credential. So once you, for example, do just do a Gmail login. So once I do that, then I can add a description, and then I'll add my email like that. .com, and then also I'll just add my password. So, and then I'll just create. So once I create that password, for example, probably the administrator has done this, I'll just be able to use this within my processes. So, like you can see, if I go to edit, I cannot see anything, but the password is there. So, if I go to my processes and I want to use that credential, for example, let me just go here and I want to use it, like for example, here. I'll just use a get credential activity in this case. So in this case, I'll just select the folder path. So where is it stored within the orchestrator? So, and then I'll select the credential that I want to pull. So it's Gmail login. It's just there, it's integrated there. And then now I'm just going to store them within variables. For example, username. And then I'm just going to add the password here to, let's say, password just for the purpose of the demonstration. So if I go to the variables that I've created, you'll see that I have created a password that is of type secure string. So already I cannot access this password. And this means that my password is protected, the system is protected. So the kind of credential management that UiPath has provided kind of ensures us that we are able to protect our credentials, our passwords, and that we don't lose any kind of information. I don't know if Jonathan has anything to add.
Thank you, Zach. I think you have addressed it clearly. So maybe David, hopefully you've answered, but purely around customer data, other than the password from what Zachary has mentioned. So for all our customer data, I believe they are encrypted both in transit as well as in rest. I know they normally use TLS, I think 1.2 plus in terms of the security enhancements. All that can be found in their website. You have the website, they'll be able to give you all that detailed information. But I believe Zakaria has addressed it correctly. Not sure if David, you're okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Awesome. Okay. So thank you very much. If you still have any questions, feel free to ask. But like I mentioned, all links are now we have been able to upload all for previous sessions. We have been able to upload all those recordings as well as the presentations. You're able to get it there. Same case, like I mentioned, next week we'll be having an introduction to web APIs. So if you have how do you call it? How do you trigger? Maybe you are interested to triggering a bot from an API. We'll be able to take you that through the same. Same case, should you want to join this session or any other particular session, we have the community. I know they have multiple sessions cutting across different topics. If you're interested in any particular topic, you can be able to access it through the community. If you have questions or you require support, we have the forum. You can be able to post there, and I know you'll be able to get support from across the entire continent worldwide. So that's what we have. If there's no other question, thank you everyone for joining, and we'll see you in the next session. Thank you everyone. Bye.